do to my sign?
I wrote the same, but in different words.
Thanks, love.
I thought to myself how interesting words can affect an outcome. Words can change the way we see life. It can cause things to happen. And before I get started in our continuation of our series, Words Matter, I just want to welcome, if you're a guest to Lighthouse Church this morning, we want to thank you so much for joining us. Thank you so much for being here. Make sure that you introduce yourself to one of the pastoral staff. We'd love to get to know you. But also, I wanted to remind all of the church members, today is Pastor Dexter and Miss Shauna's last Sunday with us as they transition into the next season of what they believe God has called them to do. And we've got a little reception that will be available for them after the service. And I don't know if you saw that there was we've been mentioning it for a couple of weeks now. There's a little basket there that you can share your ideas, thoughts, and words of encouragement through cards and things of that nature. And after service, hopefully we'll get done. I've got a very simple message for us this morning, and hopefully we'll be able to get there in a short amount of time. As you walked in this morning, did everybody get a communion cup? I think I left mine there. I'll have to get it in just a minute. Would you bring it to me real quickly? And I've got a couple extra there for you if you need one. If you did not get a communion cup, would you raise your hand? I want to make sure that our team members can help you out real quickly. If you'll do me a favor, there's some hands right over here. Keep them up so that people can see it. And we want to make sure that we have that for the end of the service. And it's amazing, you watch a video like that, and I don't know about you, but it can really impact you. Says the same thing. She made a comment. You know, she must have been a marketing major. You never know. I've heard before. I had a pastor one time. You used to refer to the nursery as kitty jail until I finally told him. I said, "You can't say kitty jail anymore. That doesn't come across well." And he stopped saying it, and eventually stopped saying it. But I was at the Alamo a couple of weeks ago, and actually there was a door with a gate on it, and I took a picture of it, and I sent it to him. I said, maybe, hey, in the 1800s, they did have a kitty jail. That's where they put them. That was their nursery. Lock them in. You never know. Words are important, and you're going to be measured by them. Pastor Candy articulated a little bit about how important it was for us to partner with the Word of God, because words are significant. Our values, our salaries. Did you realize that your relationships are the result of your words? A relationship is birthed by somebody saying across a table on a moonlit night with a flower and sweet music playing. There's words that say, "I love you." And guess what happens? Something is birthed. Something is changed. You know, there's an employee that gets promoted quickly by the person that, when the boss says, "We've got this problem," and the individual says, "I'll fix that. I'll take that on. Let me do that." Words elevate. Words create. Our position is often gauged by the value of our words. And words are revealed through their results. You know, I was thinking about it as I wrote my message. I've been writing this message for a couple of weeks now. And as we go through the next 3 weeks or the next 2 weeks, this week and the next 2 weeks, we'll be talking about how words matter. And I realize that society can be manipulated by words. Churches can be formed, guided, or misguided by words. Culture is created by them. We find out that words, worlds, the Bible says that worlds were formed by words. God said in the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, verse number 3, that the worlds were fashioned by faith. And in the beginning of Genesis chapter 1, we find how those things came forth. Kingdoms are conquered by words. Marriages are either devastated or made successful by our words. Alliances are developed every day by our words. And dreams are articulated by our words. You realize that a dream that you have in your heart never manifests until you begin to speak it out loud. You begin to declare that it's going to take place. You begin to let other people know about it. And guess what? And I'm just thinking, sitting here, this wasn't part of my message, but I saw Bryson. And Bryson began to share a dream of We Are Nashville. And as he shared that dream of We Are Nashville this year, they took that thing to the Scrimmerhorn. Hallelujah. But it took words cast before people that would hear them and help him manifest that dream. Last week, Pastor Barry shared a message as he opened up our series on how families can either be preserved or destroyed by the way that words are used or articulated. The interpretation of a word, the definition of a word, the string of words and how they're spoken and put together, how they're texted or they're tweeted, produce a response, don't they? And when I say tweeted, most of us think of a president that we no longer have. If he would just had not tweeted that, we might have him still as our president. But the reality is this, whether it's politically, personally, or spiritually driven, our words are important. They're critical to the success of our lives. There's a scope of words. Did you realize, I was doing a study this week, and did you realize that there are 800,000 words in the English language? Now, this might be for the only geeks in the room. Any geeks in the room? You don't really, some of you care about this, some of you don't. The rest of you will just check me out for a minute. 800,000 words in the English language. 300,000 of that 800,000 are medical terms that we never use unless you're in that field. Medical people are going to look at me going, yeah, there's 17-letter words, and we don't ever use that word for anything else. 500,000 words. But did you know that the average person uses only 10,000 words? And of that 10,000, we repeatedly use 5,000 of those words. So we limit our scope of communication. That's part of the reason why I love the King James translation. They say things in the King James translation that we don't say anymore. And when I talk about these words, words are added and deleted all the time. When we talk about the Merriam-Webster, 455 words were added to the dictionary last October. 455 words. What kind of words would you say, Pastor Bob? How about this? TBH. For those of you that are texters, you know what I'm talking about. It says this, to be honest. There were words that were added like BTW, by the way, or NVD, never mind. NVD, yeah, that's the one. Or how about this one was brand new in October, deplatforming. Nobody knows what deplatforming is, but it actually means this. It means to remove or ban someone from social media. It's a new word. We're adding this word. But there's new words all the time. Like, how many of you know years ago when you were younger, the word internet never existed? Now, some kids, they're going, what? There never was an internet? You mean it's not always been? No, the truth of the matter is, in my lifetime, internet was developed. Words like Wi-Fi, words like Googled, metaverse, emoji, meme. And this is the fun one that I used to fight my kids over all the time. They would say the word, they would go shopping and I need some jeggings. What is a jegging? It looks like a jean, but more like a legging? I don't know, but it's a word. But then there's words that we don't use anymore. And I was thinking, unless we're King James or maybe things have become obsolete, how many of you know the floppy disk is not used as a term anymore? How about the term britches? We don't say the word britches anymore. My great-grandma Castle used to use the word britches. You better be careful there. I'll drop your britches. You know, I'm just the correction mode. I must have been that kid. But thou, thus, and thither. How about words like speaketh and bringeth? Those are words that we just don't use anymore. That's old English. We don't use those kinds of words anymore. But the words that we choose to indicate something about us, maybe where we're from, maybe our culture, maybe our background. You know, It might even determine our generation. Words like groovy and gnarly, rad. How about dude or peace? Or maybe ciao, adios. Or how about spasiba, if you're from Mexico. Or not Mexico, Russia. It means thank you, spasiba. It indicates where you're from. Does anybody know what a bubbler is? Anybody know what a bubbler is? If you're from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, that's the only place that they know what a bubbler is. And a bubbler is a drinking fountain. We call it a bubbler. That's where I grew up. Until I moved to the South. But it indicates where you're from. They've actually done studies. People that say bubbler, they know where you're from. You're within 25 miles of Milwaukee, I guess. I don't know who came up with it. But words can also be confusing. The English language is unique. And again, I don't want to spend a lot of time here, but I want you to grasp the scope of why words matter. How about there, there, and there? How about pear and pear? How about words like pale and pale and root and root? Or how about words like rose and rose? We got rose, and then you give a rose. How about bite and bite? Computer bite, or we bite something. Or how about fawn and fawn? You got a deer, or we fawn over our spouse or our loved one. How about lane and lane? Somebody's laying down or there's a lane. How about words like ways and ways or lead and lead? There's so many words. I stopped writing them down and I thought to myself, I actually did a Google search on words that sound alike. And there was literally hundreds of words in the English language that sound similar, but yet they're different. So if a word is used, we have to be very, very aware of how that word is used because there's power in words. You know, we may not mean it. We may not intend it. But how many of you have ever gotten yourself in trouble for typing a word into a text message and it was interpreted differently on the other side as the recipient? Do you understand that words matter? I'll look at my text 4 or 5 times. I'll even show it to my wife and she'll say, no, don't send that one. Because what you don't get the opportunity to do is pull that word back. Once that word is out there, it's not possible to grab it back. It produces a life of its own. And it creates and establishes things. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 12. We're going to go there in just a moment. But the power of words, we've all heard the nursery rhyme. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. How many of you know that's not a true statement? A bone will heal, but a word may take a generation to go away. When we look at these words matter, and we understand the power of a word, an ill-communicated word, can cause so much pain. Kenneth Hagin made this statement, I'm convinced that few Christians realize this important fact. Our words dominate us. He said, words will make you a victor or they will keep you captive. They'll either cause life and produce you to have an opportunity for good things, or they will produce for you an opportunity for bad things. And as I minister this message, I've recognized I'm a glass half empty most of the time type personality, and I'm sorry to tell you that. Maybe it was my training. Maybe it was the way I was as an executive. Maybe it was through my life experiences. I have to watch my words. My wife, on the other hand, positive words all the time. The house could be falling down, and she's going to find something good to say. That's Dana. If you know Dana, that's who she is. I might look at you a little differently, and I have to pause. If you see me looking at you funny for just a moment, just realize I'm processing. Because my words dominate me. Words will make you a victor, or they'll make you captive. Joyce Meyer made this statement. She said, words are containers for power. You choose what kind of power they carry. You choose what power they carry. You can have a word. That is, my mom, I love my mom dearly, and I'm not picking on my mom in any way, but words hurt my wife when we first got married. How many of you know that moms and mother-in-laws kind of, there's some, I don't know if it's an unwritten or it just kind of is there. But when my mom and Dana, my mom loves my wife, But I can remember when we first got married, there were some statements that my mom would make. My mom would say something like, oh, Dana, I love your blouse. You know what? I would buy that in red. And all of a sudden, I'd get in the car, and my wife would be upset, and I'd say, what's the matter, pumpkin? She said, your mom didn't like my blouse. She said she would get it in red. And I said, no, that's a compliment. But how the words were interpreted was that she didn't like the blouse. Now, maybe my wife was a sensitive person. I don't know. But the reality was this. How a word is thought of, how a word is heard, has the ability to carry power. King Solomon made this statement, pleasant words are a honeycomb, sweet to the soul and healing to the bones. What kind of words are you saying? You know what? Jesus recognized the value of words. If you go to Matthew chapter 12, this is going to be our foundational text that we're going to use throughout the course of the next couple of weeks. And it's not necessarily, I'll be repeating it every week for you, but we'll teach from different aspects over the next couple of weeks. But Jesus recognized the value of what we say. And he even called people out on it. If you go to the passage in Matthew, and I give you a little bit of background on what's taking place, Jesus had just got done healing. And out of this healing, there was this argument among the Pharisees. And the Pharisees were saying to him, you must be of the devil. And he's like, how can the devil heal and cause sickness? And how is that possible? Because that would be a house divided against itself. And there was this conversation that was going on. But it indicated that he evaluated the words of the religious people. And so out of this topic, he recognized the corruptness that was going on inside of them. And I want to challenge you for just a moment to evaluate how pharisaical, how religious sometimes you might be. Each one of you have to evaluate yourself. Now, I'm not going to point fingers at yourself. I'm going to let you evaluate you. Because I believe that the text articulates something that every one of us have to consider from time to time. How many of you know? None of us have mastered the art of words. None of us have mastered their usage. None of us have accomplished where we need to accomplish. You know, I think of guys like Adrian Rogers when that guy used to preach. How many of you love Adrian Rogers? I could just close my eyes and just listen to that guy all day long. There's guys like T.D. Jakes and Tony Evans is another one. I can just close my eyes and I can just listen to them. But they're these orators. There's another gentleman that I have really loved. He's gone on to be with the Lord, and his name was Jadon George. And that guy could just string words together, da, 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 and they just had life in them. But Jesus was recognizing that the Pharisees, their words were identifying the condition of something that was going on inside. Their words revealed what was in the heart. The Bible tells us in Matthew chapter 12, verse number 33, I think we have it there for you. It says, a tree is identified by its fruit. If a tree is good, its fruit will be good. If a tree is bad, the fruit will be bad. And you brood of snakes, how could evil men like you speak what is good and right? Jesus called people names. Did you see that there? He called people names. Now, that's not a right thing to do, except if you're Jesus. Okay. For whatever is in your heart determines what you say. A good person produces good things from the treasury of a good heart, and an evil person produces evil things from the treasury of an evil heart. And I tell you this, you must give an account on Judgment Day for every idle word you speak. The words you say will either acquit you or condemn you. Heavenly Father, in the few short moments that we have in this message, I ask right now, Lord, that you'd cause my tongue to be that of a ready writer. Let me communicate, God, your gospel with clarity and truth. Holy Spirit, let people hear what you want to say, not necessarily what I'm saying. I'm being very careful, Father, because this matter is about words. So help my words, Lord, be edifying, encouraging, and producing life in Jesus' name. Amen. I read this passage of Scripture, and I went back to my 1996 translation of the King James translation, and verse 35 says something like this. It says, a good person produces good words. A good person produces good words from a good heart. And it says an evil person produces evil words from an evil heart. What's going on the inside of you is going to come out at some point. The revelation of what's going on in you. The Amplified Translation closed this verse out, or the subject matter out, in verse 37. It says this, it says, for by your words, say words. Say words. For by your words, you will be justified and acquitted. And by your words, you will be condemned and sentenced. Those are legal terms. Those are terms that we understand in a courtroom. And so whether or not I'm producing a word that will sentence me to good things, or will it sentence me to bad things? Am I going to be condemned to good things? You know, how many of you know, I'd love to be condemned to good things, right? I just want goodness to overcome me. I want goodness to overtake me. I want good things to happen. But you know what? Out of the abundance of this heart, I begin to declare. And so I'm either justified or acquitted. When we look at that legal term acquitted, it means you've been set free. That word no longer bounds you. But what happens oftentimes is we've set things into motion. Maybe it was yesterday. Maybe it was last week. Maybe it was 20 years ago. Maybe it wasn't even you setting those things in motion in your life. Maybe it was a parent, a friend. Maybe it was a loved one. You've heard words like this, you'll never amount to anything. You've heard words like this, I don't think that's smart, so you automatically start thinking you're stupid. You hear words like that, and those words begin to settle in your spirit. And whether or not you said them or someone else said them, all of a sudden you're beginning to experience a life that might not be one that is free, because you're bound by what other people have said. Words matter. The power of the spoken word is an incredible thing. Words reveal our expectations. They reveal our fears, and they reveal our anxieties. Let me give you an example. Kids, all of us learned at one point or another how to ride a bike. And there was these words that we heard because our parents ran behind us or our friend ran behind us. Whoever taught you how to ride your bike? They're holding it. And they say three words when they let go. Four words. Do it. I was counting in my head, and I thought, wait a minute, I probably should have practiced that a little bit. There's four words, not three. You can do it. And all of a sudden, you're pedaling, and guess what happens? Out of their excitement, there's something. I got it, Dad. I got it, Dad. I got it, Mom. I got it, Mom. And all of a sudden, they're like, ah! But you don't stop right there. You say, come on, buddy, you got this. Come on, you get up. I remember when I was teaching my daughter how to ride a bike, she ran into a tree. Because I had heard somewhere that you put them on a little bit of an incline on grass and let them go down your front yard. It's great. Because if they fall, they land on grass, not concrete. I was experimenting. I didn't think that a big pine tree would be the thing she saw. Because I think it was Pastor Barry or somebody was making a comment that what you look at is what you drive toward. And all of a sudden she goes, tree. Wham! And took her out. Anyway. But I said, come on, you can do it. But those words produced a belief that you could do what they said you could do. Whether it's the word of God, whether it's a friend or a family member, they produce something in you that you believed, and as a result, you learned how to ride a bike. Just as words have power and can produce life in the natural realm, they're also incredibly powerful in the spiritual realm. We'll talk more about this over the weeks to come. But I think what happens is most of us as Christians live within the realm of the context of the natural man. We don't live in the realm of our spirit man. And because we don't live in the realm of our spirit man, all we're trying to do is get through life rather than accomplishing things in the spirit realm. When we begin to accomplish things in the spirit realm, these words produce something because they're influential, both But what is influencing your words? Is it the word of God or the scriptures or the spirit of God that is influencing your words, or is it life's experience? Most of the time we live our life in such a natural format that our experience formulate our words. And what am I saying when I say that? What I'm saying is this, is we get to this place where this is what we've always done. or we've never done it that way before. And we begin to say things that formulate that minutia of what God is desiring for our lives. But if the Bible says, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength, that becomes my declaration. Is it possible? Yes. But if I never say those things, maybe I'm in question. Because there's a couple of things I want to share with you. What we believe eventually comes out. What we believe eventually comes out, good or bad. You know, as a foundation for this entire series, what you believe eventually comes out of your mouth. It eventually is spoken and gives life. And whether it's good or it's bad, the Bible says in Luke, a very parallel passage to the one that we're reading here, the book of Luke tells us in chapter 6, verse number 45, it says a good person produces good things from the treasury of a good heart, and an evil person produces evil things from the treasury of an evil heart. How many of you know that sounds familiar? But he said this is the part that I want you to see. This is why it's so important to read your Bibles. Because if you're reading one passage, somebody else might have got the rest of the story. Because look at what it says. What you say flows what is in your heart. It flows from what is in your heart. Words have the capacity to either destroy or restore. To either destroy or restore. Solomon made these statements in Proverbs. He said, the words of the wicked are to lie in wait for blood. In other words, what they do, the words of the wicked are looking to take you out. But it says the mouth of the upright shall deliver them. The mouth of the upright will deliver them. So what are we doing? Do my words have the capacity to destroy or restore? Are my words restorative when I speak them? Words have the potential to either produce life or produce death. Now, I'm being extremely redundant over the last 3 points, but I'm trying to get it to you. How many of you understand what I'm saying? And one time, my daughter mentioned to me, she said, Dad, the last 4 points of your message, they seem very similar. I said, yep, because I learned that if I can't get it in this door, and I can't get it in this door, and I can't get it in this window, and I can't get it in this window, let me try it at least through the garage door. How many of you know people keep their inside door of their garage door open? I never lock mine. You know, and so what I'm saying is this. If I can tell you that they either destroy or restore, they're either good or they're bad, they either produce life or they produce death. Solomon made this statement. He said, death and life are in the power of the tongue. What are you speaking life into? Parents, what are you speaking into your children? Employers, employees, what are you speaking into your situation? Oh my gosh, it's never going to change. Nope, probably won't. But the reality is how about you say this? I walk into a situation and say, you know what? The Spirit of God's arrived into this place. I believe we're going to be blessed. I believe we're going to be favored. I believe we're going to have more customers than we ever knew what to do with. I believe we begin to start saying those things. And guess what? It manifests because God looks over his word to perform it. But it goes on to say, it says, they that love it shall eat the fruit of it. What is he saying? What you say will come back as dinner. That's what you're going to eat. That's what you're going to participate of. I'm never going to amount to anything becomes your words. And guess what? You might not amount to anything. But let me talk to my young people in the room. Let me say this to you with everything inside of me. Your life is in front of you. You can do all things. There's so many things. Guys, those of you that want to be married, those of you that want to have a house, those of you that want a great career, those of you that want to accomplish things for the kingdom of God, begin to speak life into that situation. It might not be today. It could be 20 years down the road. But you begin to speak life. I remember Kenneth Hagin made this statement, Jr. He said, I saw years earlier that the Lord was going to use me and I was going to be able to speak to millions. And it wasn't until 2010 that he had the opportunity to go to a place called Lagos, Nigeria. There's a church in Lagos, Nigeria that is a half a mile wide and a mile long under roof. And he preached to over 1 million people in that building. But he said, I'm going to preach to 1 million people 35 years earlier. Because what are you saying? We're going to have a new building. I'm saying it. You heard me say it, Pastor Barry. We're going to have a new building. We're going to have staffs. We're going to have locations. We're going to have volunteers till they're coming out the ears and we don't know what to do because we don't know how to schedule them all. Can I hear an amen? Everybody in the room that's not volunteering went, nah. I'm not accepting that word. Nope. You're not speaking that over me, Pastor Bob. Yes, I am. But the potential either produces life or death. Words are the avenue by which your salvation comes and healing manifests in your body. The Bible tells me in Romans, it says this. It says, if you openly declare that Jesus is the Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Hallelujah. But you know what? What we expect and what we confess is a direct result of what words are being believed, accepted as true, and meditated upon. What are you thinking about? What are the things that you're thinking about? What are the things that you are processing in your mind? Is it a new business idea? Is it a new opportunity? Is it a new growth suggestion? Maybe it's something in our church that we're not doing and God spoke to you supernaturally. I met with two men this week that they said, Pastor Bob, we just believe God wants us to do this. All right, I said, let me do this. Let me help you get life to that thing. I'm excited because we're going to start seeing some things happening in that realm. But there are results of words, and I'm going to fly through a few of these for just a moment because I want to make sure that I give plenty of time for Pastor Dexter and Miss Shauna to meet you guys in the lobby and shake your hands and hug your necks for a final time. But you know what? The results of our words can be real. Do you realize in Genesis chapter 1, there was a result in Genesis chapter 1, verse number 3, that as a result of a word, light came. The words were, let there be light. There was a passage in Matthew chapter 14, verse 29, where Peter was sitting in a boat and Jesus was doing some water walking. And what did he say? He said, if that's really you, tell me to come. And Jesus said, come. A word moved a man. Sidebar. He moved a dude from the comfort of a boat, right? To make an irrational decision to get out of the boat and walk on water. When was the last time? What is God telling you to do? When you've said, God, if you really want me to do this, tell me to come. And you got out of the boat. Pastor Dexter's doing it right now. Scared to death. I know he is. I've done those transitions. They're not fun. But when you trust God, he's just basically saying, come on out of the boat. Come on out of the boat. And you live on the word of God. You live on the word of God. Christina, I just saw you there smiling at me because there was a word God gave you about the man sitting right next to you. And you got married years later. There's a word that God might speak to you. And I don't know what that is. But there were words like this, arise. And guess what? Somebody that was laying low got up. Somebody that was dead all of a sudden began to breathe again. How about this one? I am he. All of a sudden, there was a group of guys coming into a garden, and they said, are you this Savior, this Jesus? Everybody's, and all he said was, I am he. And boom, power hit, and they all hit the ground. See, there's power in words. When Jesus said, come forth to Lazarus, the guy wanders himself out of the grave. How about this? Whatsoever things you desire. There's something that happens in Mark chapter 11 and verse 24. We also understand that we're supposed to hold fast to this profession. But not only is there life producing things, there's some stuff that can get us in trouble too. I look at the word and there were words like crucify him. There were words like Sapphira said when she lied to Peter. And Peter said, is it really true that you sold the property for this much? And she said, yay, for so much. And guess what happened? That'd be the end of that lady. There's a passage, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Jude. And I don't have time to go into this sermon because I really want to wrap this thing up shortly in just a moment. But there's this passage, when I talk about the result of our words, sometimes we're not watching our words. We're not careful with our words. And in Jude chapter 11, there's this fella by the name of Jephthah. And in Jude chapter 11, verse number 30 and 31, it says this. I think we have it on the screen, don't we? It says, and Jephthah made a vow to the Lord. He said, if you give me victory over the Ammonites. Now stop for just a minute before you go to the next verse. How many of you tried to make a deal or have tried to make a deal with God? God, if you'll give me victory, look at what this guy promised. Look at the next verse. It says here, it says, I will give you to the Lord whatever comes out of my house to meet me when I return to triumph. I will sacrifice it as a burnt offering. How many wasted words do we say? That's a really foolish thing to say. It indicates, though, that he must have had a house pet. Because it doesn't say whosoever, it says whatsoever. So he probably believed that maybe the family dog might have run out of the house, but guess what? The rest of the story is his daughter ran out of the house. How many times are we foolish in what we say in trying to get God to do something for us rather than just doing what he says? See, in all of these passages and so many more, we see how words used properly, the words can be used properly and the words can be used improperly. They produce results. We could speak of the exchanges of words between Moses and Pharaoh or even Mordecai, Esther, the Hebrew slaves and Nebuchadnezzar, or Esther and Mordecai. Words are critical for creating clarity and comfort. Go with me, if you will, back to Matthew. Go back with me, if you will, to Matthew, because there's four simple things that I want to get ready to share with you as we read this passage again. Because words are critical, guys, and we're going to unpack this over the next 2 weeks. They're critical for creating clarity and for comfort. Words are not just something that we say, but they continue to produce long after they're spoken. Matthew chapter 12, verse 33. I find that something very interesting happens in verse 33. Our words will identify who we are connected with. What are you connecting your words to? Who are you connecting your words to? In this passage, it says here that a good tree, it says, is identified by the good fruit. The bad fruit is identified as a bad tree. How many of you have ever had fruit trees before? But what Jesus is talking about, going back to the illustration and introduction that I gave you earlier, we realize that he was talking to a bunch of guys that he was identifying as snakes. He recognized that they weren't good fruit. How could they say good things? Because of the type of people that they were. So our words will identify who we are connected with. Our words will expose the condition of our heart. He says in verse 35, he makes 34 and 35, he says, you brood of snakes, how could evil men like you speak what is good and right? For whatever is in your heart determines what you say. A good person produces good things. Our words will expose the condition of our heart. What's going on in your heart right now? What are the things that are guiding what you say? Third thing I saw in this passage, your words are going to be accounted for. We'll spend more time on this next week, but there's a passage in Ephesians. It's probably one of my favorite passages, and it probably erupted my life. It's in Ephesians chapter 4. It said, let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth except that which is good and edifying to the hearer, that it must administer grace. My goodness, that's a scary scripture. Because what he's saying in verse 36, he's saying every idle word you speak, every wasted word, every word that you use without thought or idea. And you know what my problem is I talk for a living, so I tend to talk more than I should. I probably ought to keep my mouth shut a little bit more. Because the reality, it says, you go back to the proverb, and Solomon made this statement. He says, you know what, even a fool looks wise if they keep their mouth shut. But why open your mouth and reveal who you really are? So we have to understand that our words are going to be accounted for. Number four, our words will determine our destiny. They reveal who we're connected to. They reveal or expose the condition of our heart. I can tell when somebody's hurting. I can tell when somebody's struggling. I can tell when somebody is in faith or not in faith by what they're saying. I've been to hospitals where people have prayed for them. Oh, Pastor Bob, I'm believing for a healing. And I walk out the room, and I'll never forget one lady. She began talking to her daughter and her son as I walked out the door after we just had an incredible prayer move of God. I literally felt the cancer in her belly begin to do this as I laid my hands on her belly. It was like it was alive, and it was just moving as I prayed. And we prayed, and we just believed God. And as I walked out the door, this is what I heard. Honey, have you got the arrangements for my funeral prepared? She died 2 weeks later. Your words will determine your destiny. Because the Bible tells us in verse 37, it says, your words will say, the words you say will either acquit you or they'll condemn you. Your words of accepting Christ can put you in heaven. Your rejection of Christ can put you in hell. Your words can reveal the healing that could manifest, or your words could say, the cancer's taken over my body. Guys, I want you to understand that your words will determine your destiny. We'll talk more about these over the next couple of weeks. But in closing, guys, could I have my worship team to come? As you guys get ready for the communion moment, this is what you need to do. Let me just remind you as I kind of make a moment pause. You want to get your little cracker out of the bottom first and then flip it over. Don't open the top and then figure out how you're going to get that cracker out the bottom, because it's going to drop all over the place, all right? So go ahead, turn it upside down, grab the cracker out, then turn it over, and then take the top. All right. Everybody good? As we get ready to close. Learning how important words are is critical to experiencing and creating the life that God originally intended for his people. Let me ask you this question. Are you interested in a better life? I hope internally you answer that question yes. I'm going to ask you a question. Are you interested in a better marriage? Do you realize that your words could create life in that marriage that might not currently exist? Do you want a better career or experience greater success? Or how about this? Because ultimately, those are superficial things. They're all going to go away. But the reality is, how many of you want just a real spiritual experience with God? If our church, every person walked in the room, God, what are you going to do today? God, what do you want to say today? God, what do you want to speak to me today? Guess what? He'll oblige. But I would venture to say that not all of us walk in the room like that. We saunter in a few minutes late. And this is not a conviction, but I noticed it again this morning, and it's been building, that we don't fill the room when the music starts. I've caught myself running from the bathroom as they get ready up here. That's not how God wants us to enter the kingdom of God or enter into his presence. The very foundation of our faith begins and develops through the realm of our words. If I'm expecting an incredible move of God, I believe God's going to move. If my words conflict with Christ, we wonder why things aren't changing in our lives. A right relationship is critical to the success of your words. Being rightly connected through that right relationship will indicate the success of your words. John chapter 5, verses 5 through 7. 5 through 7. It says, yes, I am the vine and you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. It's interesting how God used trees all the time. He talked about vines and he talked about trees and he talked about branches a lot, because he understood the depth of what we're connected to. In Matthew, he said, are you a good tree? Here he says, are you connected to the right vine? He said, when we're connected to the right vine, for apart from me, you can do nothing. Anyone who does not remain in me is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. Such branches are gathered into a pile and are to be burned. But if you remain in me, and look at what he says, my words. There's something about words that Jesus was trying to get across to the Pharisees. He was trying to get it across to his disciples. That your words are critically important. And I'm not talking about the power of positive thinking. I'm not talking about New Age. I'm talking about life giving words. Because look at it says. It says, you may ask anything you want, and it'll be given to you. How close are you to Jesus today? You live your lives. You work your jobs. You raise your children. But is Jesus the one you are connected to? Maybe that's why I felt such a heaviness this morning. Because I realized in my own life there's areas that I know maybe I'm not rightly connected completely. Have you ever had a wire that you've kind of rocked over and it's gotten weak and loose, and sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't? Anybody ever have that? It's just a wire that's been beaten over time. You got to replace those phone wires, those recording chargers from time to time, and that wire has just gotten, and sometimes it works. You turn it just right, and you turn it just right, and you get your power back on, and you hear the thing start bleeping again, or it goes, when you know you got the power. But there's a consequence for not being part or only partially being a part of the tree or the vine that identifies you in Christ. The weakness of our words is often found in the weakness of our relationship. See, the stronger your relationship with God, the more powerful your connection is to the words that he spoke. Connection to the words that he prayed, the connection to the things that he said. We need to make something right this morning with Jesus. We're going to get ready to partake of communion this morning. And you know what? As much as it, everybody got your little piece there? You know, the weakness of our words is often found in the weakness of our relationship. And as we get ready to partake of communion this morning, I think the bullet that I want you to take home with you this morning is that your words matter, but just as much as your words matter, your relationship with him matters so much more. And with every head bowed and every eye closed, nobody looking around, it's so critically important that the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart, they're pleasing to God. You might be in this place right now, and maybe your words, your actions, your attitudes, your thoughts, your ideals have caused you to walk away from God. And you just need to make things right with God right quick. Just raise your hand real quick. I want to pray with you. There's a hand right there. Anybody else? We're just talking about just making a recommitment right now to saying, God, I need that relationship stronger than it currently is. I want you more than anything else. Because if that's you, just raise your hand. I'm not gonna belabor. Is there anybody in the room that needs Jesus? You've never accepted Christ as your Lord and personal Savior. I want to make sure that we get that right. So we've only got one individual, but let's do this before we take of communion. We're going to have a final song as we close, but let's just pray this together. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you in Jesus' name. We thank you for all that you did and all that you've done, that we might have a relationship with you. Jesus, forgive me of my sin. Forgive me of my thoughts that were not pleasing to you. Forgive me of my attitudes, my actions, and my ideas that might be contrary or conflict with your word. Father, wash me clean. Make me new. Renew a right spirit in me. In Jesus' name, amen. See, if there's something wrong in our relationship, we don't have to overthink it. If there's an area or arena or closet or cupboard that needs to be made right, it's that simple. But how often do we forgo that simple prayer? And we try to make our words have power when we've actually been short-circuited in a significant way. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, it says this, on the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread. He gave thanks for it, and then he broke it in pieces and said, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with his blood. Do this in remembrance of me as often as you drink it. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes. Father, I lift up this bread to you right now, and in Jesus' name, I ask right now, Lord, that you would cause it to do what it was meant to do. Father, it's a representation of your broken body. It's a representation that through your brokenness, Heavenly Father, we can have wholeness. We can receive, Heavenly Father, all that you have for us. And so, Father, I pray, Lord, that as we as a church partake of this bread, we don't take this bread lightly. We reverence it. We honor it as considering it sacred. Now, we know it's not your body, but we know it's a representation. But God, as we remember you this morning, we desire more than anything a relationship with you. And Lord, let our words reflect that. In Jesus' name, let's partake. Father, as we get ready to take this cup, Heavenly Father, represents, Heavenly Father, the shed blood of our Savior. And the Bible tells us, Heavenly Father, that through that shedding of blood, there can be remission of sin. And thank you, Lord, that each and every one of us, Heavenly Father, in here, before we even got to this point of the service, Lord, we've had an opportunity to receive forgiveness, an opportunity to receive Christ, because you are our Lord and you are our Savior. Father, as we partake of the blood, we understand its weight. We understand its purpose. And Father, through the washing of the water of the word and through the understanding that this blood washes over us and you see us not as we really are, but you see us through the eyes of Jesus. And we thank you, Heavenly Father, that through the washing of that blood, we stand before you righteous, holy, and pure. Father, we thank you for the blood in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing a song here in just a moment, and then we're going to dismiss. Please don't forget to spend some time with Pastor Dexter and Miss Shauna. But as we sing this song, if you just need to find a place, would you stand to your feet? If you need to find a moment, find a place at the altar, you're welcome to do it. Please stand to your feet as we worship the Lord.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow.
Father, as we get ready to close this service, we ask, Heavenly Father, that we would be constantly aware that we are containers of words. Yeah. And the words that we speak, they produce life or they produce death, they destroy or they restore. Lord, they're good or they're bad. And Father, I pray, Lord, that each one of us would recognize that as we remain in the vine and we be considered good trees, help us today, Heavenly Father, to be those vessels, Lord, that bring honor to the kingdom. Father, I pray right now for the people in this room. As we go our separate ways and do our different things, I'm asking, Lord, that they would go under the unction, the power, the might, and the majesty of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Father, I thank you, Heavenly Father, that this week they will consciously be aware that their words matter. We pray right now, Lord, that as this is the final day, that we get to partake of Pastor Dexter and Miss Shauna's anointing in the role that they play. I pray, God, that as they leave this place, I pray, Lord, that they step into that new and fresh anointing, that new level of calling, that new level of purpose. And I pray, Lord, that their paths would be straight. Lord, that there'd be nothing too hilly, nothing too curvy. Father, I pray that every need that they have would be met according to your riches and glory. And Father, we thank you, Lord. We honor them, Lord, today in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. I'm going to dismiss the pastors to the lobby, and they can greet folks just a moment. But guys, make sure you turn around, shake a hand, hug a neck. Make sure somebody knows that you're grateful that they're here. We love you.